Tim.
It's the morning star drive on 7.8. You're soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the morning star drive, you know.
Hey, how's it going? It is Friday, September 25th, and this is the Morning Star Drive on 117.8. We're on YouTube, so make sure to subscribe, follow us on SoundCloud, and make sure to support us on Patreon. Today, we'll get some coronavirus updates, back to the MBTI 16 personalities segment with Wonchun, and reviewing the message from the Wednesday service. So, question I get to you every single day, and now it's the end of the week, is how are you guys doing today? Friday is here, and we're getting ready for a relaxing weekend, so I hope you guys are looking forward to some fun and a new direction through the message on Sunday. So let's start this off together here on the Morning Star Drive. Keep liking and commenting, and I want to hear from you guys and see how you're doing. Post your song requests, questions, and stories too. Testimonies are always welcome. Also, this Sunday, we'll be meeting a member from Kenya, Julius Miamo. You guys are going to really be inspired and enjoy this interview. He's going to talk about his life in Kenya, how he immigrated to Australia, and also see what he's doing right now. Going to get into his life, what happened before coming to this history, see what he's doing right now, how he came into this history. It's going to be really, really amazing. So be sure to check out the interview on the Sunday edition. Hope you guys really enjoyed the Sunday edition. Interviews, really just getting to meet each other in an intimate way and see what different members have gone through in their lives before and after coming into this history. So just want to get you guys to let you guys know also, Sermons in the Sky playlist is being updated again. So another video will be uploaded on Saturday. So let's get into the featured artist of the day. It's going to be a relaxing Friday, so we're going to start off with Jay Root from the Paper Music Associates in Korea, and the song we're going to hear is Blaze. Second song is from the Sumney Boys. We're going to get some old school songs in there. We're going to get Partners in Crime. And last but not least, the new singer we have here, we have Nature from Dio Wing. She's a hip-hop artist, and the song is Life's So Cool, and it's featuring Yebeat. So I hope that you guys will really enjoy this music from our members creating this from around the world. Guys, we can support them how? Listen to their music. Also, we can pray for them so that they can create even more content for the entire world to hear. So let's get this thing kicked off on this relaxing Friday, and we'll listen to Jay Root, Blaze.
I'll hold you tight.
저게 너의 꿈을 꾸게 될 거야. 너의 아름다움 지켜줄 거야. Just for you. 변하지 않는 건 상상이란 말은 절대 믿지 마. They will never know.
They will never know.
네가 날 알아준 걸로 충분해.
넌 나를 위해 날 빛으로 세우리 도시에 영원한 사랑 할 거야. With you forevermore. You forevermore. You forevermore. My love.
Yeah, 인트로부터 나 더 너 돌려대 쓸데없이 고치게 심장이 주는 비트를 쫓아 Yeah, 맥박에 그리는 길을 따라 재미나게 달려가고 있어 여기까지 왔어 생각에서 졌다면 이미 해줬어 꿈도 희미해졌어 초능력이 필요해서 고부고부 내 생각에 고무모무모해 멀리 있지 않아 그렇다고 가깝지도 않아 너가 정한 중특지가 멀리나마 보인다면 방향은 정해진 거야 달려가기만 하면 돼 그거 알아? 우린 지금 게임 중인 거야 목숨은 하나지만 HP 1 리필 사격해 너야
어차피
이긴 게임인 거야 Yeah, let's play
Let's play the game Enjoy the game of life 즐겨 life is so cool Let's play the game Yeah, life is so cool
남자들은 프린스 메이커맨 학교만 번 갔다 오니 뭐 이렇게 많이 커 치트키도 안 썼는데 얼굴도 몸도 미안다 커 wow. 하고 싶은 게 너무 많아 꿈도 많이 꿔 어른들이 하나같이 하는 말이 시간이 소설같이 슝 달린다더니 이러다가 나도 곧고 꼬부랑 할머니가 되겠네 안 되겠다 지금 시간 분주까지 저쪽에서 죽일 거야 HSR 네이처셀 와이드부터 하고 신나게 그렇다 야 어쩔 일도 없어 말 스트레스 받는 나만 손해인 것 같아 거리에 행복할 거리 널려 있어 찾는 만큼 내 향기도 짙어질 것 같아 yeah.
Let's play the game Enjoy the game of life 즐겨 life is so cool, cool. Let's play the game yeah. Life is so cool
And that is Life's So Cool featuring Yebby, and that's Nature from Dio Wings. I hope you guys enjoyed that new song. It's the first time we ever actually played that song. Also, we had J-Root from Piper Music Associates in Korea, and that song was Blaze. And the second song we all know from the Sumney Boys, Old School, Oldie But a Goodie, Partners in Crime. Of course, they have their new album out called Tales of a Longing Heart, so go ahead and check that out too. So that brings us into a time of the coronavirus updates for the week, and this will be the last one for this week until Monday. And just want to tell you guys a little bit something. In Malaysia, we are going into quarantine again. There is a possibility that a member could have the coronavirus. We're not sure yet. So this person happens to be, someone who's like in the church and met a lot of people. So the format for the next 2 weeks of the Morningstar Drive on 107.8, it might change a bit because I will not have access to the computers or anything else like this. So I will have to find a new way to do it. So it's really good because it allows me to innovate and think of a better way. So if it's a little bit different than the past, please understand that I will be in a hotel in quarantine. So it should be pretty fun. I'll put some updates on my my channel too, just because it's going to be hard to do the Bubble Talks and the Taco Tuesdays also at the same time. So we'll see what happens. Hopefully tests will all come out negative and then we'll be able to go back into normal life. All right, so let's get into the coronavirus updates for today. In the world, there are 32 million cases with 981,000 deaths, and that's at 3.06%. The U.S. at 7.1 million cases, 206,000 deaths at 2.89%. India, 5.7 million cases, 91,000 deaths at 1.59%. Brazil at 4.6 million cases, 139,000 deaths at 3.01%, which is really good. And Argentina, the lone country where the mortality rate went up. It's actually, I think, the third day straight. 664,000 cases, 14,000 deaths at 2.16%. France at 481,000 cases, 31,000 deaths at 6.54%. And new to the list on the top six is Israel. Israel has 204,000 cases, 1,300 deaths at 0.65% mortality rate. Philippines, 294,000 cases, 5,000 deaths at 1.73%. They are not going up anymore. And Sweden, down to 6.55% mortality rate, and Belgium, down to 9.32%. Take a look at the daily infection rates. India, 89,000 cases at 2% growth. US, 41,000 cases at 1%. Brazil's at 32,000 cases at 1%. France at 13,000 cases at 3%. Argentina at 12,000 cases at 2%. And to round up the top six is Israel with 11,000 cases at 6%. So we see that a lot of shifting. Russia comes in and out. Spain comes in and out. Colombia comes in and out. But the three countries that remain the same is India, the U.S., and Brazil. All right. That means we're going to go into today's MBTI 16 personality segment. I hope you guys I know you guys enjoy this because there's a lot of chatter in the rooms about what is going on with these different, you know, whenever the segments come out, like, oh, I'm this and I'm this. Oh, this gives me a little bit of a better idea how to do this, and this, right? So let's get into the MBTI 16 personalities with Won Chun.
Hey everyone, this is Won Chun. I hope you've had an amazing week. We're here again to talk about MBTI and personalities. And last week we were talking about dominant functions, specifically SI. And today we're going to be talking about NI, so introverted intuition. And as we've been learning, we have four cognitive functions that we primarily use. The first most is the dominant function, and which we rely most heavily on. It's mostly an unconscious kind of reliance, and it's what provides us kind of a foundation and a sense of identity. So, you know, those who use it really well with really good results, they tend to feel at their best. And on the other side, once they don't use it well, it becomes a big kind of cause for emotional pain and feeling like there's something wrong with them. So like I said last week, those that use their dominant function poorly, they tend to have a low self-awareness of themselves. Okay, so anyways, we have SI and we have NI. So SI we talked about last week, NI. They can really seem similar on the outside, but the SI and NI are on totally different edges, right? They're on totally different platforms. And both of them, they tend to need a lot of, like, they stockpile information before they feel comfortable and have confidence to take part in the real world. And, you know, they both seem kind of cautious, conscientious, reserved, although they are totally different. And when faced, you know, when it comes to us, you know, when we're faced with new or difficult situations and circumstances, you come to really learn about how you behave in those situations, and then you're able to kind of see which cognitive function you actually naturally fall back on. For SI, or introverted sensing, it tends to be a function that keeps you meticulous, like it keeps meticulous records of your subjective experiences of, like, the sensory type, so the physical things. And so based on those things, they determine what they'll do with that new information that comes in. On the other side, NI, introverted intuition, which we're talking about today, it creates a subjective impression of how kind of things evolve in front of them. And it's about visualization. So if you think visualization, what could happen, or the implications of those things, to fill in those blanks sort of things. So both INTJs and INFJs, they use NI as their dominant function. So NI is a perceiving function, just like SI, and it relies on abstract connections. And it is, like, NI speculates about, like, the potentials and things that could happen in front of you. And NI tends to create, like, a symbolic image or impression to set direction for themselves. So it's not so concrete as it is, like, more of a thing in their mind. And INTJs, INFJs are naturals at making, like, very intuitive connections subconsciously. So it's something that they don't even really think about. It's just connected. And a healthy TJINFJ are very aspirational in wanting to live for like a higher purpose. And so the more mature INTJ, INFJs are known to be very insightful and wise and very earnest in their convictions that they have. And they're really good at envisioning and like meaningful goals for them to strive towards and to deal also with those potential complications that come in. And, you know, I guess at their best, they are very focused and ambitious and disciplined to realizing those ideals. Cool. So here are some signs that you're not NI dominant or INTJ, INFJ. So you're not the contemplative type. You know, you really think deeply, or you don't tend to speculate how things might turn out. You have no sense of aspiration, and you don't tend to think of purpose or your calling or your direction. And you like to live by your whims or your urges, and you don't require any structure. And you're very literal, you like the details, and you enjoy mundane conversations. So if these are you, then you're probably not in NI, 100% actually. And these next questions will determine whether you're an NI or not. If you get most of them, then you're probably dominant in this function, NI. Or, you know, if you only just get some of them, then maybe you have it, but it's not something that's your dominant function. Cool. So, you know, you got to look at your life and see those consistent patterns as you listen to these questions, okay? All right. So first, are you confident when you have a strong sense of purpose to guide you, especially in terms of your longer term goal or your direction? And on the opposite side, do you feel easily adrift or really at unease, and you find it really difficult when you're unable to move forward when you don't have you can't figure out what really matters in front of you? You know, you don't have that core in front of you. So next question for you, it's important to have a very clear idea and also a strong impression of the whole thing in front of you, an idea of the clear direction. And do you naturally combine and connect that gathered information to learn about or to discover connected or overarching ideas or even like really underlying meanings of the future or like the implications of that? And do you have a hard time when you don't have those guiding principles or philosophy in life? Cool. Next question. Do you often visualize what would be the ideal way or state or situation of things? Or do you find yourself prone to perfectionism or having controlling tendencies in pursuit of that ideal that you have? And especially when you feel low, do you find yourself judging things in life as being shallow or, you know, being superficial or trivial or insignificant or very unmeaningful or even pointless? And do you suffer when your future seems uncertain or you even feel really negative about those things, and when things don't reach the level at which you envisioned it? And do you tend to dislike those who seem self-limiting or narrow-minded or shallow or short-sighted? And lastly, sometimes you get feedback of being really sensitive or even presumptuous or pretentious and quite hard to please or hard even to read or even to know or unrealistic or vague. Or sometimes that they say maybe that you overthink things or you're over curious or you're not much fun or you're not very funny. So if this seems like you, congratulations, you're NI dominant. Cool, so I said a lot of positive things, but there's also things that people might say when you're not feeling so great, right? So this type is really strong, kind of one of the 16 personality types. It's supposed to be the most intelligent type because they're so driven to connect and to think and to see future paths in front of them. So anyway, Thank you so much, everyone, for joining in again for MBTI. And I hope to see you guys next week. See you later.
All right, and thank you, Wonchan, once again for that wonderful segment on the MBTI 16 personalities. I hope that a lot of us here are going to look at and see ourselves, but also not just seeing ourselves. We can see other people. Why? Because sometimes we need to learn how to deal with people in those areas too. So I hope that this will really, really help all of us when it comes to management also. All right, so what does that mean? It means that it is time for us to have a time of praise and worship together, that all of us can give glory to the Holy Trinity in the way that they would like. And of course, all around the world, those of you guys listening, let's sing these three songs together. The Tower of Love, The Lord is Calling, and Prayer is Work. So I hope you guys put on that praise, put on your praise righteousness, and let's give glory to the Holy Trinity.
I love dream, my Lord has appeared secretly, just like a thief. Who's that calling me? Is that his voice? Could it be the voice of my Lord? He's far away, too far to see. We cannot meet, not in the flesh. Yet I hear his voice, I hear him calling, crying, anxious, filled with love. He told me, call me and I'll come. Promise me you'll call, I'll be there. Who believes?
Fruit grows, ripening over time. 40 days.
That is Prayer is Work. What an epic song. But you know what? This is, yeah, what an epic song. It sounds like a like an amazing musical. It does. It sounds like a song that's from a musical, which ties into our song of choice, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. So let's go into today's word study for the Wednesday message. And the Wednesday message, of course, great message as always. And I'm going to just go over a couple things that I really, really enjoyed from the Wednesday message. And of course, it was the first part was really good for me because I'm someone who likes to enjoy reading the Bible and dissecting and looking at, oh, what does this mean? But when Sunsie went over like Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 and 36, I was just like, whoa, that's like it's just really it's so insightful to see how to see how Sunsie sees it. It's just so different. Of course, the very first verse was Jesus went through all the towns, verse 35, went through all the towns and villages, teaching their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. Okay, so, you know, that's just kind of like, okay, cool. And, you know, right off the top, he's like, you know, Jesus didn't just tell people, the other disciples, to go out and do that. Like, Jesus was doing it himself. He was literally, he wasn't, you know, he did, when you think about this concept, it means that there was so much work to do that even him, like in this one country of Israel, wasn't able to do it all by himself, that he needed others to go out and preach the gospel. And he sent out people in twos. He sent out the 12. He sent out the 70, right? And when you think of this, he wasn't sending out like, you know what, I just want to train you guys. No, it was because it was really needed. When you think about the verses, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few, in verse 37, right? And which basically means that there is so much work to do that even Jesus couldn't get it all done by himself. That while he's doing that, he's seeing how much work there is. And man, whether these guys are ready or not, I've been training them, I've been working with them, I got to send them out. And it was, for me, it was like, yeah, it's true. It wasn't just sending them out. He was doing the work and realizing there is so much work to do and we got to go out and do it. And it's kind of like, it feels like that's kind of the feeling right now, where, you know, we hear all these stories in the message, like even on Wednesdays, like, you know, I've been working from Monday to Wednesday, meeting people, talking to people, giving them the word, helping them to overcome, and I'm just swinging the sickle of the word because these people need it, but there's so much work to be done. I cannot do it by myself. I am a single person. And he's basically just working in Korea right now, right? Calling people in Korea here and there. But if you, and I'm, for those of you who don't know, he's like, there was like, there's just meetings he does all the time, right? On Tuesday, there's a meeting I believe there's a meeting for Faith Stars, and there's a meeting for this, and the meeting for that. It's just, there's so many things going on if you think about it. Right? I think on last Saturday, there's a meeting for leaders. He's doing so much, but he realizes there's so much left that you got to send the people out. It's time to harvest. There's so much work to be done, and it's time to do it right now. So I really, that part was really kind of inspiring for me. Like, yeah, he's doing it himself, just like Jesus was doing it, and he realizes there's so much to be done. And it makes sense from the Sunday message where there's work that you need to do on your own, but there's work that needs to be done together, and now is the time to harvest together. So I thought that was a really inspiring point. The next point was even bigger. For me, I'm just like, whoa, like, where, like verse 36, oh man, like how do you get, it's just the only way you can do it is if you're actually putting the words into action. It's the only way you can understand all this or to get it at that level. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd, right? So it's kind of like, oh, okay, so, you know, yeah, he's had compassion on them. He's helping them out. And then it goes into, yeah, just the way he sometimes sees things is so different. He's like, yeah, there's people who are, you know, people have a hard time in church. And we, you know, whether it's financially, whether it's in their families, individually by yourself, your own character, your friends, right? Church people, with your leader, whatever it is. Right, there's many people struggling right now, and we need to have compassion on them. We have to see, we have to resolve their problems, right? And that came in the message too, right? Resolve the conditions before harvesting. Swing the sickle of the word, right? And then they'll work hard again. And it's an amazing way to interpret it, right? Because resolving the conditions is a great concept, because this is from the past also, where I was so shocked by this interpretation that Sunstein gave maybe a year ago. Maybe more than a year ago. He's like, why does Jesus heal them? Because if they're not healed, they can't listen to the word, because they're just stuck in their, there's such great problems in their life. They don't have enough food. Like, what are they going to care about God if they don't have enough food? What are they going to care about, like, the words of God in the Bible if they can barely live, or they have nowhere to stay? Like, what does the Bible do? Right? They can't even listen. That's why Jesus had to heal them first before giving them the word. And it was the same thing here, is resolving conditions before harvesting, right? Before you harvest, you need to have what? You have to resolve the condition first of planting the seeds or having something to harvest, which means you need to plant the seeds, fertile soil, fertilizer, watering the fields, right? Taking care of the crops, making sure the mice and the bugs don't come in and take away the harvest. Like, there's just so many conditions that need to be resolved before you can actually harvest. And in the same way too, it's, we have to resolve the conditions of these people that are struggling during this pandemic, financially, not having a job, not maybe not having enough food for their family. Just so many different things are going on right now that we have to realize that more than just, hey, the word says this, so do this. The word says this. Come on, man, what's wrong with you? The word said this. We have to be the ones that use the word, right? Using the word, swinging the sickle, encouraging the people, giving them hope, resolving this condition in their heart. Because if you have no hope, you lost a job, you lost your business that you put your entire life savings into, like, well, it's not going to be like, hey, didn't you listen to the word? Maybe not, because you're so worried and frustrated, like, oh my gosh, God, what do I do? I don't know, right? That you may not even listen to the words well. But we need to resolve the conditions before we harvest, which is it's compassion. Like, it's like that verse. He had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless. They were sheep without a shepherd, right? And I think, you know, one thing that we really have to do is, before we are like telling people what to do or telling them what their problems are or giving them the resolution or the answers, we really need to have compassion on the, hey, what's going on in your life? Is everything okay? Right? Not just, hey, are you going to Preton? Hey, are you doing this? How come? What's wrong? Right? It's more of, hey, how's everything going? And we have to have that compassion for people, and we have to resolve it first before anything else. And this is when we're going to see people really making great changes in their life. Of course, and Sunstein was like, you got to harvest with the word. You got to harvest with the word. Right? And it's just, it's amazing, like, because I was wondering, I'm watching it live here in Malaysia. I watched the live in Korea, which means it's always an hour early for me. And I'm for the Wednesday service, I'm wondering to myself, We never start late. It's like 7:06, already 7 minutes late. Why are we starting so late? And then Sunstein says in the message, he's like, hey, I've been managing people the last 3 days. I'm putting the words into action, right? And I wrote the message in the cart on the way as one page, but it's enough for 20 pages. And it's really inspiring and motivating just to see the way Sunseem does it, right? Like, it's true. When he believes it more than anything else. He's not just saying, once the word comes out, we got, you know, that's God telling us what we need to do. He's not just saying that. It is literally happening, right? Literally, he is, the moment it comes out, he's managing. He's going out harvesting the people, harvesting people outside the domain, people who are struggling, who don't come to church anymore, people who used to work hard. Like, he's calling these people, delivering the words. If you look in the Proverbs 2, these people are like excited because the word's been delivered. They're like, yes, this is what it is. And it's really inspiring to have a leader that does that. And it's up to us too, that we're not the ones that just listen to the words. We really have to be the ones that the moment the word comes out, we got to take care of these people, right? We got to harvest them as much as we can. And we have to harvest them quickly, like the message says. Do things quicker in order to harvest, right? And that's why right after the message, he quickly called people, contacted people, seeing how they're doing, putting the words into action right away. Because the only way you can manage more quickly is if you manage more quickly by doing things quicker, right? That's the only way. Like if... You know, if you're just kind of lazy and you take care of someone and, you know, it takes 3 days to do it because you're not really like taking care of them and you're not really doing it with all your heart, then 3 days is just going to be on one person, where Sunseem now is 3 days straight just talking and calling and talking and calling and contacting them quickly, just looking to put the words of God into action. And it's a cool thing because even in the beginning of the message, it's only one page that he wrote. He's writing it on the way. And the crazy part is like, the Holy Spirit says, just tell them your experiences. Your experience is the word. And it makes sense in concept, but when you listen to how Sunseem does it, like the thing that blew my mind was the walnut tree. Like, yeah, I saw a walnut tree, and then like I think squirrels were eating them. We're like, okay, like squirrels are eating them? Like, all right. So I told them we're to harvest. Harvest all the, and we look at it and they're green still. So they're not fully ripened yet. But he just says something so profound from that one thing. He says, even if it's a little unripened or early, get them before the squirrels take everything, right? In the same way, there's people that need to be harvested and they might be a little bit unripened, right? They might not be fully ready, but you gotta get them now before Satan does, right? And it's kind of, don't you think it's kind of mind-blowing, honestly? Like, I'm like, what? It is very, very mind blowing, right? That it comes from this. Yeah. So yeah, just for me, just looking at this, like, wow. Like, that's really, really amazing. Right, so I thought to myself, wow, it's so powerful the way he does it. It really is. It's really, really powerful. Just look at the walnut tree, and then the word comes from it. I'm just like, wow. So your experiences become the word when it's actually you're really, really experiencing it. Like, you're experiencing it. You are contacting the Holy Spirit, and you're getting the inspirations. Like, this is it. And you're like, whoa, that is so it. Right? You're like, that is so profound. Harvest before Satan takes them away. And the time we have right now, we have to all do it together. Okay? So I hope that really opens our eyes a little bit more to the Wednesday message. And I hope that everyone kind of gets more from it also. And this is going to bring us into the song of choice. Yes, I know 2 days ago I missed out on it. Axel, thank you so much for just pointing that out. I know I missed it. But those of you in SoundCloud would never know. But on YouTube, I was called for like copyright infringement. And they would not allow it on YouTube. So I had to edit it out so people on YouTube couldn't get it. But don't worry. Yesterday it was fine. And today should be fine too. Now, today's song of choice is once again, just like last Friday, it's going to be a musical. Last one we played a song from Les Mis, from Lea Salonga, from the Philippines. And this one's going to be from America. This is one of my favorite musicals of all time. I've seen a lot of musicals, and I saw this one twice, once in Korea, once in New York. This is the musical called Wicked. And this is wicked, like wicked good, okay? One of my favorites. It's so good, guys. You guys will love this musical. And those of you guys are old school, it's a story within the story of The Wizard of Oz. And when you watch it, man, just the way it's written is amazing. It really is. And of course, the main song of this musical, everyone knows who's seen the musical, is Defying Gravity. So good. It's about the Wicked Witch of the West, like the Black Witch and the White Witch, right? And it shows you how that relationship formed and the story of how, you know, how one became wicked or is perceived as wicked. But yeah, super amazing song. You guys got to watch it live. But I wanted to play the original recording with Idina Menzel, obviously from Frozen, you know, let it go, you know, and then Kristen Chenoweth. And these two are super famous because of this musical. Well, yeah. But here's the setting behind it, right? So they're both going to like school, like witch school, I guess you'd call it, right? So Defying Gravity is the finale for Wicked's, the first act of the musical, right? Where Elphaba, which is the green, the green witch, the black witch, right? Has seen the Wizard of Oz as a heroic figure who can give her life. Who can give her life some type of noble direction, right? And but then she's discovering that he's not all what he seems. So the wizard's regime, like the Wizard of Oz, right? His regime, in fact, is kind of waging a propaganda campaign against the animals of Oz, right? And who have been these animals have been oppressed to such a degree that they lose their powers of speech or worse, and then they can't speak at all. Okay, so realizing this. And Galinda is the White Witch, right? She's a ditzy White Witch, like from a rich family. And Elphaba is the Black Witch, and she's green. And realizing this, Elphaba, the Green Witch, or the green, you know, the Black Witch, despite Galinda's attempts to dissuade her, Elphaba vows to do everything in her power to fight the wizard and his sinister plans. So she sings of how she wants to live without limits, going against the rules that others have set for her, trying to convince Galinda to follow her, and by a moment without success, right, Galinda doesn't follow her. So during the song, Elphaba, apparently cornered by those who are hunting her, enchants a broomstick to levitate, and in the last verse rises from the stage and levitates above the angered citizens of Oz who try in vain to bring her down, right? So the song is widely regarded as being this is like the signature song of the musical, right? Of course, there's other songs that are good in it, but like this is the song, right? So I hope you guys, this is amazing. And when I watched this live, there was a standing ovation right after this song was sung. So good, okay? So this is from the musical Wicked, and the song is Defying Gravity from the original Broadway cast recording in 2003 by Idina Menzel and Kristen Chenoweth.
Elphaba, why couldn't you have stayed calm for once instead of flying off the handle? I hope you're happy. I hope you're happy now. I hope you're happy how you hurt your cause forever. I hope you think you're clever. I hope you're happy. I hope you're happy too. I hope you're proud how you would grovel in submission to feed your own ambition. So though I can't imagine how, I hope you're happy right now. Elfie, listen to me. Just say you're sorry. You can still be with the wizard, what you've worked and waited for. You can have all you ever wanted.
I know,
but I don't want it.
No,
I can't want it anymore. Something has changed within me.
something is not the same. I'm through with playing by the rules of someone else's game. Too late for second guessing. Too late to go back to sleep. It's time to trust my instincts. Close my eyes and leap. It's time to try defying gravity. I think I'll try defying gravity, and you can't pull me down.
Can't I make you understand? You're having delusions of grandeur.
I'm through accepting limits. Someone says they're so. Some things I cannot change, but till I try, I'll never know. Too long I've been afraid of losing love, I guess I've lost. Well, if that's love, it comes at much too high a cost. I did our might, defying gravity. Kiss me goodbye. Glenda, come with me. Think of what we could do together.
Unlimited. Together we're unlimited. Together we'll be the greatest team there's ever been. Glenda, dreams the way we planned them. If we work in tandem, there's no fight we cannot win. Just be willing, defying gravity. With you and I, defying gravity.
They'll never bring us down. Well, are you coming?
You're happy now that you're choosing this.
You too.
I hope it brings you bliss. I really hope you get it and you don't live to regret it. I hope you're happy in the end. I hope you're happy, my
there is or was, is ever gonna bring me down.
I hope you're happy.
Oh my goodness, that is so crazy. Oh my gosh, it just brought me back to seeing that musical again. It is so inspiring, guys. Yeah, if you guys want to see me, can you guys, you got to imagine seeing that live. Can you imagine that if that was live? Yeah, it was so good. And even when I saw it in Korea, man, I didn't see this musical until I was in New York, so It wasn't the original cast, but I saw it in Korea, and it was mind-blowing. It was even Korean, and I still was mind-blown. It was so good. But either way, if I have a recommendation for a musical, there's like the classics, like Cats and like Les Mis, Phantom of the Opera, like those ones. And then there's like the newer ones. Like I saw Aladdin. I saw Beauty and the... I saw the Disney ones. Plus, but I saw Wicked. Wicked was so good. I saw Lord of the Rings, which was only in England, and that was the most expensive musical ever. But it was really, really interesting. But yeah, you guys, now it's so... And those of you guys who know Wizard of Oz, you guys got to watch it. You have to, because the story is so smart. It really is. Okay, so this is gonna bring me into a time where it's kind of the thoughts of the week, right? And the reason I'm bringing up the thoughts of the week is I just had this really, really great conversation with another member the other day. And it was also kind of tied in with the Taco Tuesday. Oh, no, the bubble talk I did last week on laughter and humor and how it reduces stress. But, you know, my main talk about that point was how it allows us to become less rigid. Like, it lessens rigidity, and it also it grows resilience. And you're like, how does laughter do that, right? And the reason why this came up, because I was discussing with a friend of mine, another leader, about rigidity and flexibility as a leader. And I was talking about this laughter and humor that helps us to become more resilient and lessens rigidity, okay? So how does laughter and humor, like, give you more resilience? And resilience is the word means to bounce back. Right? To bounce back from a difficult situation. Doesn't mean you don't get into them. We all get into them, but resilience, the more resilient you are, the more you bounce back from those difficult times, right? And how laughter and humor allows you to take the punches of life better, it's because if you're able to laugh and able to, even like the most serious situations, just, you know, get into a situation where you can laugh about it, it makes you feel that the situation isn't as bad as you thought it was. It's really important, right? Because it's not as bad as you thought. It's not that bad, right? And it allows us to have that that feeling like, oh, it's really not that bad, because you can laugh about it. And when you can laugh or have humor and laugh even in those situations, because you feel the situation isn't as bad as you thought, you will take on these issues more, right? Because if someone doesn't have laughter and doesn't deal with them very well, what happens is you're always thinking these situations are so big and so serious, and it's really hard to tackle. Because when we get into these very difficult times, one of the things that happens is we get, our mind goes into that stress mode, and it goes into fight or flight. So you're either going to fight it or you're going to fly away from it. But if you think the situation's really, really serious and big, then you're more inclined to flight, to run away from the problem more than fight it. So when you have that laughter in your life and be able to enjoy these things, it builds resilience, because you face more problems because you don't think they're as big as they really are. And because you face more problems, you become less rigid. Right, which means you're more flexible and you're more reasonable in every situation. So you see that resilience leads to flexibility, because when you are going to deal with the situations, a lot of times you're like, what, it's too hard, it's nothing like I thought it would be, and you're always expecting things to turn out the way that you want. But when you're someone who can laugh about it and you see that, oh, okay, well, it didn't turn out this way, so let's see how it happens here, we become more flexible with it, because we're dealing with lots of these problems where most of them don't turn out the way that we think or should it should happen. And sometimes we need to be more flexible, right, when it comes to each situation and circumstance, right? Like, I'll give an example is, like, imagine you're working and you have this big job meeting, right? When you're going to... But oh no, you can't miss Sunday service for this, right? And then people become very rigid in that sense. Oh, you can't do that. But it's not always the case, because you gotta think about it. Some cases are not gonna work that way. Like, imagine you're a doctor. If you're a doctor in this coronavirus time, do you think you can go to every Sunday service? Probably not. And Should you get mad at them if they don't wake up on Sunday? Like if they've been working like 3 days? No, you shouldn't. It's a different situation. We got to be more flexible, right? Because if you become very rigid, it's like, you cannot miss service. You shall not pass, right? Like on Lord of the Rings, right? You shall not, like you can't miss it. But we have to see things for the level of what they truly are, right? And if we can laugh at something, it may not be as big as we think in our heads. And if we can look at it properly without being so stressed about it, then we may not see it as small as it is either. Because whether you see it too big or too small, both will cause issues. But you know, it means that sometimes we just need to relax, right? Like in this history, it can't just be all evangelize, evangelize. What are you doing? Harvest, harvest right now. Why aren't you harvesting? Hey, harvest this, harvest that. Harvest, 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 harvest. And we're like, oh, I'm so stressed because it's kind of the harvest. Did you hear the message? The most important thing you can do is evangelize. You must harvest, right? And it's like, right? When we see things, we don't relax and we don't have a fun time and we don't enjoy what we're doing, then every situation is OMG, we are dead. Like, it's kind of like that. We completely lose the point of view, right? It becomes too hard. And we can't handle many situations. We can't be resilient. We think it's too hard. We fly away from a lot of these problems, right? So I hope that all of us here too, like we can enjoy, you know, we need to enjoy this history and have that balance, as Sunseem said this week, right? In the Tuesday message and the Sunday message, balance. Don't be too physical, don't be too materialistic, and don't be too faithful, over-righteous, over-wise, right? Like there's a great verse that Solomon talks about this too, and it makes more sense, right? I believe it's in Ecclesiastes, right? And I believe it's, Ecclesiastes 7:16, it says, do not be over-righteous, neither be over-wise. Why destroy yourself? And then on the flip side, don't be over-wicked and don't be a fool. Why die before your time? So I hope that all of us here too can have that good balance. We need to take a break, right? If you wake up late for pre-dawn, don't freak out. Just pray at that time, right? Nothing is very, very few things that are like, there's only one time in my life where Sunseem, I saw him never seen him so like desperately, like, why didn't you skip work? Why didn't you do that? The only time when he talked about skipping work, flying to Korea, was on March 16th, 2015. That was the only time ever. This is the last time in history. But every other time it hasn't been like that. It's very rare to see that, right? So I really hope that we can lessen the rigidity and become people that will really be able to be flexible and reasonable, okay? So I hope that with the thoughts of the week that we can think more deeply and understand even more what's going on in this life. And I hope that we'll be able to have an amazing weekend with the Lord. Yes. So I hope you guys had a wonderful Friday podcast. You know, I just, once again, just tell you guys, I'm in quarantine, which means that I don't know what's going to happen next week for the next 2 weeks, how much I can do, or I'm going to do it for sure. I just don't think I can do it as well as I do it now because I won't have the same equipment. But please bear with me because it'll be quarantine MSD for the next 2 weeks, all right? So I'm going to be in a hotel and stuff too, so I hope the internet's good enough also. All right, everyone, have a wonderful, wonderful weekend, and we'll see you guys again on Monday for the Morning Star Drive on 117.8. Whoops, that was the wrong intro. That's One Chun's intro. Sorry, guys. I'm going to do this better, okay? Everyone, have a wonderful weekend, and we'll see you guys again.
It's the Morning Star Drive, 117.8. You're soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride, and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the Morning Star Drive, you know. I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this.